whales are cool, but they have not always been swimming in the ocean. Now, in fact, whales evolved from this, Pachycetus, a type of ungulate the size of a wolf. Ungulates have hoofs. But whales are big. They dive deep. Sometimes they echolocate, and sometimes they like to eat plankton. So how did this turn into Moby Dick? I've got the evidence, and I've got the transitional species to show you. Let's get into some evolutionary business. But first, I have to apologize. I got a package delivered during my video I posted 2 weeks ago, and I didn't show you what I got. So, check this out. I got a stepladder. One thing to know about me is I love redecorating. Approximately every 2 weeks. It has not one, not two, but three. Oh, I heard it crack. But three steps. Perfect for me, because I'm short. Now I can reach the ceiling. Okay. Back to the whales. Before we get into the evolution, I'd like to acknowledge some of the records that whales currently hold to speak to how incredible their evolution has been. Of course, they're the largest animals on the planet, with the blue whale being the largest animal by mass to ever exist that we know of. The largest have gotten to 110 feet long, and sperm whales are the largest living animals with teeth at up to 65 feet long. They're also the smartest marine animals by human standards. Some dolphins have passed the mirror self-reflection test, where they are essentially verified to recognize themselves in a mirror. They inspect parts of their bodies that they don't usually see, kind of just check it all out. And that's a big deal. Very few animals have passed the mirror self-reflection test. Some whales are also known to have regional accents. Orcas have been known to participate in cultural trends. They're like water people, dude. I say let's give them hands and see what the fuck happens. They also have incredible diving capabilities, considering they are air-breathing animals. Sperm whales, as you might know, spend a lot of time diving to snack on giant squid, but they don't hold the record for the deepest dive. That title belongs to Cuvier's beaked whale. I think that's how you pronounce it. One dive was documented at 3 hours and 42 minutes long, getting down to nearly 10,000 feet below the surface of the ocean, which is just outrageous. They also sometimes got echolocation, which isn't really a record, more of a fact. I mean, they are the largest animals to echolocate, so boom, record. And also sperm whales do this thing called clicking. It's a sound signal at a certain frequency that is strong enough to be heard miles away. And is also strong enough to paralyze or kill a human if they're swimming in the ocean close enough. What the fuck is up with that? Okay, I'm gonna stop with the random whale stuff because I'll just go on forever. Long story short, they are sensational cetaceans. And they all evolved from an ancestor that looked something like this prehistoric ungulate 53 million years ago. Okay, so how do we know this? Because at first glance, this might seem outrageous. Whales evolving from ungulates seems kind of random. It was a surprise to paleontologists too. There's a few key skeletal features that account for some outstanding evidence. To keep it simple, we're gonna go over two of them. The first one is an ankle bone called an astragalus. Mammals have either a single polyastragalus or a double polyastragalus that looks like this. Here's a comparison of the two. Most mammals have the single polyastragalus, and ungulates uniquely have the double polyastragalus. And a double polyastragalus can be documented in the transitional fossils of whales. Boom, ungulates. Okay, but how do we know that these transitional fossils are in the whale lineage? What if there's something else? Well, first, there's consistent morphological changes from prehistoric ungulate to whale that can be seen in the skeletons throughout the fossil record, like the nostrils moving further and further up the snout until it reaches blowhole, and the pelvis reducing in size along with the hind limbs, which became vestigial or useless and then just totally non-existent. But fun fact, some whales today are still born with little tiny little nubs of vestigial hind legs in their body. But there's a different key piece of evidence that connects whales to their transitional fossils, an ear bone. Mammals have this bone dome that encompasses the middle ear called the tympanic bulla. It supports the eardrum. In whales, that dome is really thick, dense and thick, and is so unique and recognizable that it gets its own name, the involucrum. The involucrum is found in all whales today, along with the entire lineage of transitional fossils. It's a cetacean sensation. It helps with the density of water. So all whales and their ancestors have an involucrum, the ear bone, and the ancestors to whales had a double polyastragalus, the ankle bone, just like ungulates do. Now, let's talk prehistoric species. But quick note, I am about to show you an absolutely heinous animation, and you'll see why in a second. But it shows one species evolving into another, or almost like morphing, like a fucking Animorphs thing, which kind of suggests that this evolution was a linear progression. That is not the case at all. None of these transitional species are considered to be the direct ancestors to modern whales or even to each other. And evolution isn't a straight line like that in any case. It's more like a family tree. I drew these before the video so you wouldn't get the glare. Clearly, I'm still figuring out my sound and lighting. So a simplified version of the whale family tree we might have is this. Don't grade me on accuracy, please. I just did it. And each layer of the tree would represent a different period of time. So like maybe we have these two from 30 million years ago. So we have an understanding of what some of these species looked like at different time periods, what some of them looked like 25 million years ago, 15 million years ago, not what the direct ancestor to whales looks like. Confirming direct ancestry is really hard, really, really hard. So think of these more as like, we have a great uncle and a great grandma's sister. We got relatives, but not mama. All right, roll the clip. Smithsonian, please update that pronto. It's triggering an indescribable sense of doom that I don't think that you're going for. Was this made the same year as Polar Express? Because it kind of feels like it was. Has the same energy. I get that same feeling in antique stores. You know, with the little, like, cartoon characters and the dolls. It makes me want to throw up. Anyone else? No? Actually, you know what? We're just going to keep going with that. As a sense of unease to this video that I'm honestly not mad about. So, let's just roll the clip. Starting off with the first cetacean in our lineup. Pachycetus, represented by this gremlin. Here's a different picture. Pachycetus looks like a pit bull and a rat had a baby. And I don't mean in the artist reconstruction. The depiction is great. I mean in the general morphology. That is a rat dog, and you can't tell me otherwise. Not this one, though. This one looks like you separated every molecule of Pachycetus and then tried to put it back together. Anyway, as you might guess from their name, Pachycetus was found in Pakistan back in 1981. And by the way, cetus means whale, Pakistan whale. And it was a huge deal because it was the transitional fossil that paleontologists had been looking for and hoping for decades. Because before this, since like the mid-1800s, they had absolutely no clue where whales fit in the mammalian tree and what their ancestors looked like. And Pachycetus changed everything. Pachycetus was really early on from the transition from land to water, alive about 53 million years ago. They were about 3 to 6 feet long and had both the double pulley astragalus and the involucrum, well, a simplified version of it at the time. Their fossils have been found in deposits that would have been freshwater streams, and they likely spent a lot of time there, hunting in or near the water and maybe using it to hide. And for some reason, these early whales found life to be easier near the water. Over thousands and millions of years, as they would start to spend more and more time there, their bodies would adapt to better fit this lifestyle. That might be hard to imagine with such drastic changes over such a long period of time. So let me show you some modern examples to help. With cats, both the flat-headed cat and the fishing cat alive today have semi-aquatic lifestyles, and both have webbed feet. An adaptation to help them better hunt in the water. They're water cats. But don't get any ideas. They're wild animals, not pets. I will hunt you down myself. And we're even starting to see some lions become semi-aquatic. Okay, that's actually a little dramatic because it's really early on. But back in 2019, a population of lions in Namibia found their way towards the coast. There was an abundance of seals there. Life gives you lemons. And they started timing when the seals would ride back in on the waves and hunt them. And that's what they're doing right now. The point is, shit happens. And small changes can lead to really big changes if you give them enough time. Millions of years. And a couple million years after Pachycetus, Ambulocetus stepped onto the scene. Somehow simultaneously looks like a thumb and a crocodile. Here's a better picture. And as you can see, they were equipped with some brand new, one-of-a-kind, wet, paddle-like feet. Shorter legs and a stronger tail. And based on where their fossils were found, they probably lived in estuaries with both saltwater and freshwater. Oxygen isotopes in their bones led to that conclusion as well, because you are what you eat, and shit will stay in your bones for eternity. So whether you're drinking freshwater or saltwater will lead to different isotopes in your bones. Ambulocetus fossils had both. Boom, estuary. Next up, Miocetus, or as people on TikTok would say, the most average dog in Ohio. Let's use a nicer pick. Miocetus translates to mother whale, because the first Miocetus fossil ever found had a little baby little Miocetus fossil inside of it, a little fetus. There was the possibility that it was a snack instead of a baby, but there was seemingly no damage to the skull, which would have indicated that it was a prey item, or any damage to the skeleton at all. So, probably a baby. Not only is finding a fossil like this insanely cool, but it also helped to hint at possible reproductive behaviors of whales at this stage. The orientation of the fetus, and the fact that it was very close to term, led scientists to believe that this would have been a head-first birth, which means Miocetus probably gave birth on land. Whales today do a tail-first birth, so the baby doesn't drown. So even though these whales from 45 million years ago were spending most of their time in the water, they might have still been giving birth on land. But we don't deserve to say that for sure yet at all, with a sample size of one. So it's cool evidence, but for now, it's just that. And now with the most normal looking dude in this animation, Dorodon. Dorodon. Dorudon. Dorodon. Dorodon. Finally, we have a whale that looks like a whale. At this point, as you could probably gather, their hind limbs were presumably useless, just little nubs. So they were using that strong tail to propel them through the water, with the classic up and down undulations that we know and love about whales today, rather than the fishy side-to-side movements due to restrictions of the original terrestrial mammalian backbone. They undulate. Undulate is only one letter away from ungulate. 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 Coincidence or government conspiracy? Dorodon got to about 16 feet long and was alive about 40 million years ago. Its fossils were initially found in Egypt at a place called the Valley of the Whales. They find tons of prehistoric whale fossils there because that area used to be a shallow sea. Tens of millions of years ago. They've also been found in the United States and New Zealand. When Dorodon was initially discovered, their fossils were thought to represent juvenile specimens of a different prehistoric whale species that was alive at the same time and also found at the Valley of the Whales, Basilosaurus. Basilosaurus was first discovered in Arkansas and was named and studied by Richard Harlan, Dick Harlan, who knew the thing was big and definitely lived in the ocean because there were small little shells found in the sediment surrounding the fossil. He noticed some similarities to Jurassic marine reptiles like plesiosaurs and ichthyosaurs, which definitely another another case of convergent evolution. And so without certainty, Dick Harlan was like, let's just call this the king lizard, and went with the name Basilosaurus, which translates to that. Then comes along Richard Owen, Dick Owen, who looked at the teeth, and he noticed they were super mammalian, double-rooted. And he came to the conclusion that the king lizard was actually a mammal. And he tried to change Basilosaurus's name to Zeuglodon so that it would make sense, but they were like, no. Basilosaurus is already registered. You are SOL. And so now the prehistoric whale is constantly presumed to be a marine reptile or a dinosaur. Basilosaurus was big. They could get to like 60 feet long. They also had little tiny useless little hind limbs like Dorodon and generally had the same overall structure, just bigger. And like I said, they were also alive at the same time, about 40 million years ago, and have been found in the same places like the Valley of the Whales in the USA. So it definitely makes sense why Dorodon fossils were initially thought to be juvenile specimens of Basilosaurus. But they weren't. There's plenty of other cool prehistoric whales that I could tell you about, like the Leviathan whale, the only known competitor and potential predator of the Megalodon, but I'm eventually gonna get to that in species spotlight videos. Since this is a whale evolution video, I will stick to the whale evolution. Like, what the fuck is up with baleen? I hate the word baleen, dude. Sounds like an old woman with a nasty attitude. Baleen is long, thin sticks of keratin that acts as a filter for the little planktons they scoop up from the water. And it seems like some whales have had it for at least the last 23 million years. The transition from teeth to baleen is a pretty bizarre one, and scientists still don't know exactly what that looked like. For a long time, it was thought that maybe these transitional species had a mix of both baleen and teeth, and then just got more baleen over time, but some new fossil evidence suggests that they might have lost their teeth entirely before the transition to baleen and did suction feeding for a while. But again, we need more fossils to confirm or deny. And why the fuck are they so big? What's up with that? Another thing we don't have concrete answers for, but we do have some hypotheses, and I'm going to share one of them with you that I learned about in my paleontology class in college. Since 35 million years ago, there have been larger species here and there, like Basilosaurus or the Leviathan whale. But about 5 million years ago, they all went into bulk mode. And it turns out that around that same time, there was a natural global warming period. So ice sheets were pouring into the ocean, bringing with it minerals and nutrients from land, just flushing in, which theoretically fed a massive amount of plankton, which delivered whales an all-you-can-eat buffet all the time. That would leave no restrictions on how much food they could have found. So they just got fucking huge. And in the ocean, it takes a lot less energy for a larger animal to move a certain distance than a smaller animal, so it's still helpful for them to be that big. And now we share a planet with an animal that can get to 330,000 pounds. If you like this video, be sure to subscribe so you don't miss my next long form video coming out next week, and you can keep up with my daily short form content on TikTok and Instagram, with the occasional one posted here too. And for now, stay curious. The world has a lot for us to learn. See ya!